them, it's pretty hard to comment on it.
Right.
I will tell you what I have said from the very beginning, that sexual orientation discussion, debate is long overdue. The legislature has a responsibility to introduce it, to get it into committee, to hold hearings, and let everybody come in and talk about it. I know that they are at opposite poles a little bit now on some of it, and the only way that you're going to reach a compromise is to get all the information out and get everything discussed and go from there.
When you introduced your act originally, was there a lot of opposition? What were some of the struggles that you faced back then with it?
Well, we had the handicappers who were not included in the bill. We had the gays who weren't included in the bill. And so we in fact reintroduced it in 74 to and then waited until we passed the disabilities or the physically challenged bills.
Right.
When that happened, then we move forward. But people forget that the civil rights movement was originally about being black.
Right.
And that was the focus. And justifiably so.
Right.
And so now, in a more complex world where we have a lot of Asians, a lot of Arabs, we have the largest Arab population in the country. We have the second largest Chaldean population.
Right.
The Asian Indian, the Asians that are in, and now the Mexicans coming in greater numbers than they were before.
Right.
Is presenting problems. So it's an ongoing, evolving issue. So sexual orientation is just one of them.
Part
it's,
of it, yeah.
Long overdue.
How does it feel seeing something that you did?
Thank you. Curtis, remember Curtis from the kickoff?
Oh, I sure do.
Curtis says, hey, you know your picture with Curtis is on the website?
No, is it really?
Yes. Let me see if I pull it up for you.
How does it feel seeing something that you did all these years ago growing constantly since you've done it?
Well, I think it says that the legislation has been good for the citizens of Michigan. It has worked. It gives citizens a place to go to air their grievances, to find out if it's valid, and it doesn't cost them anything to do that. And they still have the choice. If they don't like what the civil rights tells them, they can go take it to court.
Right.
So, I mean, the bill, more people should probably read the bill.
Right.
and see what's in there, but it's very well written. So I'm glad to see that it is still working. I think that the department is sorely underfunded and understaffed. They do a yeoman's job on very limited resources. And when you listen through this seminar of all the things that need to be faced and done, it says the legislature should also step up and greatly fund the Civil Rights Department at a higher amount of money.
One last question for you. What prompted you to do this in the first place? Why did you introduce this act?
Well, I think that we had the Civil Rights Movement started in the 60s. Slavery has been a burden to this country since day one. And those of us, I was teaching in the Catholic schools at the time, and in Pontiac we went through the anti-busing, we went through the burnings. Hispanics were not recognized by the city. I mean, I can give you a whole list. I mean, the time was right. There was no reason not to do it. Plus, the feds had done it,
right.
And we modeled the bill after the federal bill. So, I mean, it all made sense. And as I said, it doesn't take much to be nice to people. And I don't care what your bias is, you don't have the right to act on it.
Absolutely.
Known as the Larsen Civil Rights Act, a piece of legislation that has had and continues to have a profound impact in Michigan. This piece of legislation is recognized as the most comprehensive and inclusive civil rights law in the country, providing protection and prohibiting discrimination based on religion, race, color, national origin, age, sex, or marital status pertaining to employment, housing, and other real estate, public accommodation, public service, and educational facilities. Since its passage and subsequent amendment, this act has served to expand the categories of personal physical characteristics that are protected from discrimination to include height, weight, familial status as additionally declared civil rights. The act has been further amended to broaden existing anti-discrimination protections in the workplace, pregnancy, childbirth, or related medical condition. The Elliott Larsen Civil Rights Act continues to evolve and raise important issues. For example, an emerging civil rights issue includes whether or not the act should include discrimination, anti-discrimination provisions based on sexual orientation and gender identity, or better known as LGBT. So I want to, without further delay, I'm honored to introduce to you my friend and the first moderator for this first panel, Mel Larsen.